Good morning. Today, in introduction to signals and systems, this is the second video lecture of signals and systems. Today, I will cover classification of systems, because classification of signals along with their all types of characteristics are over. So now we will go to classifications of system. When a system is classified, of course it is classified with respect to time. Number one is static and dynamic system. Number two, that is time variant and time invariant system. Number three, that is linear and non-linear system. Better to write it as systems, non-linear systems. Number four, causal and non-causal systems. Non-causal systems. Whereas the number five will be stable and unstable systems. So these are the five systems, or these are the five classifications of a system. So whenever we will tell about a static system, we can say this is a system in which the parameter variable, whichever it is, that will be constant throughout. That means with respect to time, the parameter variable will not be changing. It's a static system. For dynamic, of course, whatever be the parameter variable, it will be changing with respect to time. Since this is the characteristic of dynamic system, so we can tell that all types of differential equation, as well as difference equation, as well as derivative and integration, will be associated with dynamic system. Now let us just write one example of dynamic system. I will write two examples in the form of continuous time and in the form of discrete time. So if in the form of continuous time I will write it, let it be like this. So this is an example. These are all the, you can say, 4, 3, 2.5 and 4.2. These are all the coefficients or weights that is associated with either the dependent variable y or the independent variable x. As n is present over here, n is nothing but the number of samples, as I told before also. You can see over here, from this xn, it is related with yn, and this x of n minus 1, this is related with y of n minus 1. So you can say this particular system, it is dependent on past as well as present condition of input, and as per that we are taking the result. So this much for dynamic system in discrete. If in continuous we will write, let it be write like this: 3 d2y dt square plus 7 dy d dt plus 5 y of t equal to say 4 d2x dt square plus 8 say dx dt plus 7 x of t. As you can see over here, from in the initial the input is given as x of t. From this x of t we are getting the output as y of t. As the system parameter is changing itself with respect to time, we are going to the first derivative of x. With respect to that we are getting the, of course there will be change in the output also because y is in the output portion. Similarly, there will be double derivative also, d2y we are getting because this is the change in the output which is the consequence of change in the input. So these two are the examples of dynamic system, the first one in discrete form, the second one in the continuous time format. So now we will come to the second one. It is told as time variant and time invariant system. That means there is a system that is varying the parameter variable with respect to time. There is a system in which the parameter is constant with respect to time. So time variant and time invariant system. Let us suppose a time invariant system is known as a fixed system because it is not changing itself. Now let's see the condition. H of this is the expression for a time invariant system.
Right shift, the output will be changed by the same amount.
Now, what is a particular thing that will be a time variant system? Because if I will assign this as equation 1 and if I will assign this as equation 2, suppose there is a particular system which is not holding for equation 1 as well as equation 2, then it will be a time variant system. Time variant system means where with respect to time some parameter will be varying. So if there is a one particular term, if the time invariant system will be linear also, then what will be this? Then it is known as LTI system, linear time invariant system. So this is a very important thing for any particular system, and it is a very important perspective for signals and system. So now we will go to the next one, linear and non-linear system. So let it be written like this. X1 of t and x2 of t are two variables. A1 and A2 are the weights, or you can say they are particularly two coefficients which are associated with these two inputs. So now in the right hand side we will get like this. This unique property is known as principle of superposition. You can see in the left hand side A1 x1 of t, that means x1 of t is the input, plus A2 x2 of t, that means x2 of t is another input. A1 and A2 are two coefficients or weights which are associated respectively with x1 of t and x2 of t. Similarly, on the right hand side, whatever we are getting, by the principle of superposition, we are getting that this particular weight or coefficient is multiplied with the, with what? With the response. H is actually showing you this response. Response of the input. You can see over here, that means we are just multiplying here. That means here we are taking this as total and here we are separating these two things. Just separating the input variables. So we can see over here, suppose in a nutshell, if we will say H is the response of a system, if X of t is the system, then what will be the result? Result will be Y of t, that means this is the output. Clear? And if this will be not followed, so what we can say? We can say that a linear system is defined as one whose response to the sum of the weighted inputs is same as the sum of weighted responses. You can see over here, these are the responses. This is one response. This is another response. So, sum of the weighted responses you can see over here. And here you can see when the weights are associated with the input and when we are taking the sum and then we are taking the response of all total, and here whatever we are seeing, the weights are associated with the response, and then after that we are taking the sum. If this particular thing is not followed by any system, then we will be telling that system as a non-linear system. Now, how diagrammatically we can express this thing? Suppose we can write it in discrete also. Suppose x1 of t, it is multiplied by the weight or the variable a1 is given over here. Here we are doing the addition. Similarly, x2 of t will be coming from here. Here a2 is present. Clear? So now we are adding both of them. Then we are giving this to h log, because it will give the response of the summation. So here what we will get, h a1 x1 of t plus a2 x2 of t. Clear? Now how we will get the right hand side? X1 of t, straightforward it will go to h, then it will be multiplied with the weight x2 of t. Both the things are added here. So from here we will get the result like this: a1 into h x1 of t plus a2 into h x2 of t. So this is the result. In this way we can represent the superposition principle. So our system that will be following superposition principle is known as a linear system, else it will be a non-linear system. Now coming to next one, or better, we will go for some example of linear and non-linear system. Suppose a problem is given like this, that dy of t dt plus 2y of t equal to x of t. Show that if this system is linear or not. So first we will do it for y1 of t and see what result we will get over here. Subsequently we will get this thing. And y2 of t and x2 of t. y2 of t equal to x2 of t. Clear? So now we are dividing into two output variables, y1 and y2, as there will be two input variables x1 and x2. Now multiply these two equations by a1 and a2. So a1, here also it will be multiplied by a1, here also it will be multiplied by a1. This one a2, here also it will be multiplied by a2, here also it will be multiplied by a2. And after that, add both of them. So what we will get over here? We will get a1 dy1 of t dt plus 2 a1 y1 of t equal to plus, sorry, this term will be added. So a2 dy2 of t dt plus 2 a2 y2 of t equal to x1 of t into a1 plus x2 of t into a2. So this we will get. Now if I will take d of dt as common, then see what we will get over here from this thing. If we will take d of dt as common, a1 y1 plus a2 y2 plus, in this side if we will take 2 as common, then a1 y1 of t plus a2 y2 of t equal to a1 x1 of t plus a2 x2 of t. So we can see over here the response of the system to the input, whole input, that means a1 x1 of t plus a2 x2 of t, we can see the response over here, that is a1 y1 of t plus a2 y2 of t. It is going over here. After that further if we will go, then we will get this one. So this system is then a linear system. But suppose if the problem will be given like this, that if the question will be coming like this, then show that if this system is linear or not. As this particular integer is present over here, then we can see over here, for x1 of t, if we will do like this, that this is the y1 of t dt plus y1 of t plus 4 x1 of t. If we will multiply the whole by a1, then excuse me, whole by a1 over here. Similarly, a2 plus y2 plus 4 x2 of t into a2. Now if I will add these two equations, then see what I will get. From this addition, the result will be like this: d dt of a1 y1 plus a2 y2 or you can of course write a1 y1 of t, a2 y2 of t, and they are dependent on time, plus a1 y1 of t plus a2 y2 of t plus 4 a1 plus 4 a2 equal to a1 x1 of t plus a2 x2 of t. Now if we will see the superposition principle over here, then the response of this summation a1 x1 of t plus a2 x2 of t, of course this will be this one, and further we can proceed over there. What about this factor? How it can be equated with another factor? So that is not possible. Hence, this system is a non-linear system. Coming to causal and non-causal. What is a causal? What is a non-causal system? A causal system is one where the output is depending. Of course, every time the output will be depending on present values. A causal system is one where the output is depending on past values of input also. That means present output will be depending on past and present values of input, whereas non-causal system is one where the output is depending on the future values of input. Let's see some example, then we can tell this thing. Suppose this is the first one, y of n, of course this is a discrete. 0.5, this is the weight or variable associated with x of n. So present and present condition, minus x of n minus 2, past condition, causal system. Y of n equal to x of n, present system, but here it is very difficult to tell whether it is a causal or non-causal. Of course, it is not depending on the future values. As it is not depending, you cannot see over here, it is depending on the past values also. So, this particular system, we can say, as this is depending on the present system, because the refined definition of causal system is a causal system which is depending on the future values of input. So, this is a causal system. Now, if I will write it like this, this is a past value. This is the present value, x of n. So, from this, we can say that this value, you can see over here, it is depending on past and present values of input. So these are all causal system. Now let us see this one. Y of n minus 1 equal to x of n. That means if n minus 1 is present over there, here no values are present which is of n minus 1, n minus 2 like that. Here all the values are on the right hand side starting from x of n. Now n is greater than n minus 1, that means the output is depending on the future value of input. So it is a non-causal system. Next, see this one. Y of n, suppose we are writing like this, 0.11 x of n minus 1 plus x of n minus 0.8 x of n plus 1. Here also we can see the output is depending on the future value of input. So it is another example of non-causal system. Coming to the last classification, that last classification is known as stable and unstable system. Now, there is a very important term which is known as BIBO, which means bounded input, bounded output. Bounded input, bounded output, BIBO. That means, what is a bounded signal? Where the amplitude of the signal remains finite, that is a bounded signal. If it will go infinite, then it is not a bounded signal. That means the amplitude of the signal should be within some range. There are some conditions. Number one, if the system transfer function is a rational function, then the degree of the numerator must be no longer larger than the degree of the denominator. When we will advance in the signals and system, we will see there will be one particular term known as characteristic equation. Transfer function is what? Transfer function, it is actually the Laplace transform of the output divided by the Laplace transform of the input. Now, if the transfer function is a rational function, then, and we are knowing what is rational function and what is irrational function, where there will be no repetition, that will be a rational, where there will be repetation, that will be an irrational function. Now, coming to this, the degree of the numerator must be no longer larger than the degree of the denominator. How we can tell this thing? Suppose if we are writing like this h of s, which is Laplace transform of h of t. Suppose h of t, instead of x of t, we are writing h of t. This is the Laplace transform. That means now we are coming from time domain to frequency domain. This is the complex frequency domain or S domain. In S domain, there are two axes. As I told before also, if this x-axis, we are telling this as real axis, which is normally for continuous time, which is the time axis. Let us tell this as sigma axis. And this imaginary axis where we are putting our output or with respect to which we are doing our plotting, let this as j omega axis. Because this is the imaginary axis. So what will be happening? S will be the combination of sigma and j omega. So we can write it like this, S equal to sigma plus j omega. Suppose one particular point is over here. Suppose this point is, this is say 0.5, this is 0, this is 1, this is 1.5. Now, suppose this is 0.5, this is 1, 1.5, 2, 2.5. Suppose this is 2.5, 2, 1.5, 1. And this is 0, this is say 0.5. So if I will do like this, so we will get the result that it is 1.5 plus 2.5j if we plot this point. Now in this we will get Laplace transform of output divided by Laplace transform of input. So it can be further written like y of x divided by x of s. Because now from time domain we are shifting ourselves to complex frequency domain. Now here it is telling that here this transfer function, if it is a rational number, then the degree of this numerator, suppose this function is like this, 4 d2y dt square plus plus y dy dt plus y of t equal to, say here it is given as 3 plus 2.5 plus 1.5 plus x of t. As we can analyze this, we can see over here the highest is up to second derivative, where here the highest is up to third derivative. That means here the highest degree that will be 2, here the highest degree that will be 3. So the degree of the numerator must be no larger than the degree of the denominator. Or another example, if we will remove this thing, what the degrees will be same. The poles of the system must lie in the left half of the S plane or within the unit circle in the Z plane. Poles means what? Suppose this is the sigma, this is the j omega axis. What are poles and what are zeros? They are actually nothing but the roots of the denominator. Suppose we are representing the numerator and the denominator in the form of quadratic equation. So whatever be the roots of the denominator, suppose it is given like this, h of s equal to, suppose y minus 1, y minus 2, here it is x minus 2, x minus 3, x plus 4. Suppose it is like this. So from here also we can see degree maximum we are getting over here as y square minus 3y plus 2. Here we are getting it as x square minus 5x plus 6, which is further multiplied with x plus 4. So x cube term will be coming over here. From here we are getting, suppose these three roots, so if I will plot them, this will be 0.5, 1, 1.5, 2, 2.5, 3, like this. Clear? So if I will plot them, then what we will get over here? Then we will get over here like this, that 2 will be over here, this is 1, 3 will be over here, this is another. If only these two are there, then this system is a stable system. But here we can see that one more thing is over here. This is minus 0.5, this is minus 1, this is minus 1.5, this is minus 2, this is minus 2.5, this is minus 3, this is minus 3.5, and this is minus 4. So one point is over here also. That means it is an unstable system. Not all the roots are on the left hand side of this plane. This is an S plane. This is the left hand side of the S plane. This is the right hand side of the S plane. So not all the roots are on the left hand side. Some roots are on the right hand side. So this particular thing is an unstable system. What is the third condition? What is another condition? There is one more transform known as Z transform. For Z transform, again we will just see, we will make similarly real axis and imaginary axis. Within modulus means the magnitude. Suppose if the poles, this is an unit circle, radius is of unity, unit circle. Suppose if all the poles, all the roots of the denominator are lying within this unit circle, if it will be in the origin, here, anywhere within the unit circle, of course this is a stable system, else unstable system. If a pole lies on the imaginary axis, suppose the pole is lying over here, it must be a single order one. Then we are not calling this as degree, we are calling this as order. It is a single order one. That is, no repeated poles must lie on the imaginary axis. So suppose we are writing this equation in this form, that there are two poles who are lying on this particular point, then it is an unstable system. So this is another condition of stable system, that there should not be repetition of poles in the imaginary axis. No repeated poles, repetition of same poles or no repeated poles must lie on the imaginary axis. This is another condition of stable system. Of course, if there will be only one pole, then this is a single order system. So these are the three conditions. If these three conditions are not satisfied, then this system is an unstable system. We are already knowing about the shifting property. Coming to the next one, we are going to folding property. What is folding property? This operation is done. This operation is done by replacing the independent variable n. Suppose x of n is there. We are replacing this independent variable by x of minus n. Clear? This results in folding of the signal about the origin, that is n equal to 0. Suppose if I will plot it like this, this is for n, this is for what? X of n. That means the output. If some values are present over here, now it is shifted. Suppose this is position 1, this is position 2, this is minus 1, this is minus 2. Suppose it is shifting itself from here to here. That means instead of xn, now we are writing x of minus n with respect to this origin where n equal to 0. That is known as folding property. It is nothing but reflection of this signal over here. That is, there is also one particular property known as time scaling. Time scaling. What is time scaling? If some independent variable, if n is some independent variable, now if I will write it as kn, where k is an integer, then this process is known as downsampling. That means if x of n is the discrete time signal, then we can write it as x of n is the discrete time signal, x of t is the continuous time signal. Continuous time signal, another name is analog signal. By sampling we are getting this discrete signal. Now, if we will write it like this, x of nt, where t is what? T is the time period. We have seen over here, if we are drawing like this, then this will be our time period, x of n. Sorry, this will be x of n, this will be n. Then for discrete, we are getting like this. Clear? That means this operation, from where we are getting discrete signals from continuous signals, is known as sampling operation. If time scaling is done, then the time scale signal y of n will be what? Y of n will be x of kn. We can further write it as x of knt. Because now, n is multiplied with k for downsampling, and as we are seeing over here, t is also coming. This implies that the sampling rate is changed from the frequency, that is the sampling rate, it is changed from 1 upon t to 1 upon kt. So this is the changing, and this decreases the sampling rate by a factor, that is k, because this thing is multiplied over here, so this value will be reducing again. So that is why this is known as downsampling operation. That means it is decreasing the value. Of course, there are some particular things, that means how we can represent continuous time, how we can represent discrete time system. In the next lecture session, I will discuss.